What is going on, everyone? My name is Jason, and this is the new iPhone SE. So 2020 is shaping up to be an exciting year for Apple. No doubt there's a lot of hype and souped up expectations around the iPhone 12, as this is the year that we anticipate a much needed design overhaul for their flagship smartphone. But on the other side of that coin, Apple used the early part of this year to drop this guy, the newly refreshed iPhone SE. And man, as soon as this thing was announced, it got a ton of attention. The spec sheet, the build, design, and of course that $399 price tag got a lot of due recognition by pundits and consumers alike. However, it didn't stop the critics from calling the quote-unquote new SE as anything but. It's virtually identical to the very dated iPhone 8 when it comes to physical design, and even the components that are inside are all within Apple's portfolio of technology today. Now, in order to get a better sense of what this phone is all about, I picked one up for myself, and I thought I'd share with you guys how it's been using this phone 1 week later. Now, before we get into the review, if you're into checking out the latest consumer tech products before you buy them, or if you're just a tech head like me, I make a video like this every single week, so make sure to hit that thumbs up button, and don't forget to subscribe so you can be the first to know when a new JSL review is out and you don't miss anything. And quick question for you guys, it was a tough decision, but I ultimately ended up going with the black version of the SE. Do you guys think I picked the right color? Curious to get your thoughts? Let me know what you guys are thinking in the comments down below. Okay, first, let's talk physical design. As someone who's gone from the iPhone X to the XS Max to the 11 Pro Max, it was quite a transition to go back to the smaller, more compact size of the SE. To give context, the last time I had an iPhone with this design language was back when I had the iPhone 6. And I have to say, it was weird to go back. That said, let's start out with the positives when it comes to physical design. For a phone at this price to have the default quote-unquote flagship design blueprint of a glass-on-glass metal design is no doubt impressive. You get the same quality of materials you get on higher-end iPhones, and the same could be said of the overall build. Apple doesn't cut any corners when it comes to integration of parts, and everything from the way the display melts into the frame, to the clickiness of the buttons. There's no question that this is an extremely well put together phone with premium components. The only visible difference that you may notice from the iPhone 8 is that the Apple logo has been centered without any additional iPhone branding, making for a cleaner look that aligns with the rest of the new iPhone fleet. I think the all black here really enhances that stealthy clean look. And the main takeaway after having this phone in my hand for the past week is that it's in no way, shape, or form a stereotypical budget device when it comes to look and feel. Now, with the smaller dimensions, it definitely feels small compared to what I'm used to, but I'll be honest, not particularly in a bad way. I'd be lying if I said I wasn't worried that my user experience would be lackluster due to the fact that I've been on bigger phones for a while now, but 1 week later, I have to say that it's been almost refreshing to have a phone that I could legit comfortably use with one hand. It's been a while since I've been able to do that. Now, of course, it comes at a significant cost. No doubt the biggest negative when it comes to physical design is the very dated screen-to-body ratio. As almost all phones, even many budget ones, have transitioned to a now standard all-screen design, the extreme bezels, forehead and chin, and the front-facing home button all come together to make this new phone feel immediately old. Just take a look at the side-by-side here and you'll get what I'm talking about. Now, I will say, honestly, I don't really focus on the dated design. From a user experience standpoint, it's still fantastic, and it's a real credit to iOS just being iOS. And when I remember that this phone is only $399, it almost shifts whatever heartburn I have for the design into a sense of appreciation. As antiquated as the design of the new iPhone SE may be, there's no doubt that it embodies the elements that go into a flagship phone, and at that price, the concessions that I outlined here have been more than acceptable. Okay, but let's be real here for a second and address the elephant in the room. This phone is rocking a 4.7-inch sub-1080p display. The specs themselves are difficult to fathom in 2020, and by far the biggest adjustment for me has been getting used to this tiny display. Honestly, the resolution doesn't bother me too much at all. Sure, it's not the crispiest panel out there by any means, but at this size, everything is still sharp, colors are vibrant, and the display can get decently bright. It supports features like haptic touch, and even True Tone, which is a nice addition, and in all honesty, it's a good display, especially for a budget phone. The real concession here is the lack of immersion the display has, which is particularly pronounced if you're coming from a newer iPhone. Text is smaller to read, things like gaming is not as engaging, and the same could be said about consuming video content. Again, I would say like 90% of my user experience on the new SE is fine. The lack of screen size really isn't an issue, but if you do game often or use your phone as your primary device to consume multimedia content, you may want to invest the extra dollars and go for something like the iPhone XR or the iPhone 11. Overall, after a week of using the new iPhone SE, I for sure have gotten used to it. And to me, I would say it's more than doable for a majority of the people out there. Now, I will throw in a caveat to say doable isn't the same as enjoyable, so keep that in mind when you're thinking about which iPhone is best for you. Okay, next, let's talk about performance. Without a doubt, one of the crowning features of this phone is that it's rocking the creme de la creme A13 Bionic processor, the same chip that's inside the much more expensive iPhone 11 and 11 Pros. I mean, that's pretty incredible considering that the A13 Bionic is praised as one of the fastest and most powerful processors in the market today, and I don't think it would have been too unreasonable for Apple to have gone with, say, the older but still beastly A12 Bionic, considering the price. Now, with the display on the new iPhone SE being pretty low maintenance when it comes to power consumption, the A13 Bionic can really spread its legs here, and staying true to the SE lineage, the performance on this phone is fantastic. Apps load super fast, spec-intensive gaming is seamless, and navigating around the UI is completely stutter-free. Where you really start to see the gains of the A13 is in the SE's ability to take advantage of Apple's complex image processing tools on its cameras. The fact that features like next-generation smart HDR and portrait lighting are not only available, but can also be viewed live on the viewfinder when using the camera, it may not seem like it's a big deal, but that requires an immense amount of power, and the SE handles it without a blink. Now, some other impressive areas of performance. The new SE is IP67 water resistant, which is really rare at this price point. The stereo speakers are surprisingly good and enjoyable to use. And though the battery life for me after using this phone for a week has been pretty average, the fact that the SE can support wireless charging is again pretty ridiculous. Now, if you've had a relatively new iPhone, it's not gonna seem any different in terms of day-to-day use, but that's kind of the amazing point, as again, this phone is a fraction of the price. Now, you lose Apple's Face ID capability, which is honestly kind of sad. I'm a huge fan and advocate of Face ID, but I forgot just how good Apple's Touch ID is. It's super fast, the haptic feedback is addicting, I do enjoy being able to securely unlock my phone faster, and navigating around iOS with the home button has always been quick and efficient. Overall, the performance on the new iPhone SE is outstanding, and not to beat a dead horse here, but really phenomenal when considering the price. Okay, last, let's talk about how my experience has been with the cameras. The SE comes with a rear-facing 12-megapixel camera, as well as a 7-megapixel front-facing camera. When it comes to the selfie camera, my experience so far has been pretty good. Selfies come out sharp, and maintains Apple's color signature of being more accurate, and not as heavily processed as competitors. The portrait selfies look great, edge detection is strong despite not having depth sensors like the new iPhones, and overall, if you have good lighting, you're gonna enjoy this camera. It's not the most advanced hardware available, and it can't take advantage of premier software features like next generation HDR, and can only shoot 1080p video at max 30 frames per second, but these limitations don't make the SE's front-facing camera anywhere near bad, as it's probably still one of the best cameras that you can find at this price point. This is especially true if you factor in the rear-facing camera. It doesn't have any of the limitations the front-facing camera has, and the images you're able to capture are excellent. Images are sharp, dynamic range is on point, the single lens portrait mode works very well, and you get the same class-leading optically stabilized 4K video recording in either 24, 30, or 60 FPS, which is kind of insane. The only omission that I'd say is noteworthy is the SE's inability to use Apple's new night mode feature. It's disappointing because I think it technically could, especially with the A13 Bionic, so this was likely more a strategic decision from Apple not to include it, more than it is any limitation with its hardware. Despite that, I mean, let's really break this down. You're getting near identical quality on this camera as the flagship iPhones, which have been deemed to have the best cameras available on any smartphone right now. It's to me the biggest value proposition behind the new iPhone SE, and I'm happy to say that it delivers. So when you put it all together, in many ways, Apple has seemingly out of nowhere released the best budget phone available today. You're getting so many flagship features here, it almost dwarfs the phones that would try to compete against it. And after a week of using the new iPhone SE, I feel more confident than ever saying that this will likely go down as one of the most important iPhones ever made. It's going to allow so many more people to get a modern iPhone who couldn't in the past, while also disrupting a segment of the smartphone market that Apple has never played in before. It'll no doubt force competitors to step up, and I'm excited to see what they bring to the table because of this. But hey, that's just me, and I know there are still some out there that aren't sold on this phone, so let me know what you guys think. Do you think the new iPhone SE is as important to the general consumer market as much as I think it is? Or do you think that this is all just smoke and mirrors, the typical Apple Jedi mind trick? Let me know what you guys are thinking in the comments down below. Okay, that's about it for this review. Don't forget to leave me a thumbs up if you guys found it useful, it really helps me out. If you guys have any questions about the new iPhone SE, leave them down in the comments, and I'll be sure to get to you. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next one.